When this president was elected, he promised to reset with Russia, suggesting that the previous administration was to blame for a negative relationship with Russia, as well as the rising of the seas and various other straw men. To support that reset, he slashed our missile defenses, which Russia has never liked. He didn't trade them to Russia. The president gave them away for nothing. This isn't the third site which everyone, including our allies, found out about in the middle of September night in 2009. He also canceled the multiple kill vehicle program, the kinetic energy interceptor, and the airborne laser, and other programs. He didn't test the mainstay of the GMD fleet for 5 years. He has slashed the missile defense budget from a projected $9.4 billion to $7.8 billion in just 1 year. Prior to ever proposing the sequester, the president cut more than $3.7 billion out of missile defense agency budgets and then pleads poverty when it comes to our East Coast site to protect the United States from an Iranian ballistic missile program, which intelligence community has consistently warned could reach a maturity by 2015. If you look at the missile defense budget over time, which you can do on the TV monitors around the room, are those up?
Yes, sir.
You'll realize that the FY15 budget request proposal by the administration is actually the lowest since the Clinton administration's FY01 budget, which was prior to the U.S. withdrawal from the ABM treaty. But we have a reset with Russia. And of course, today, we see the results of this reset on the ground in Ukraine. We see increasing signs of Putinist intervention in Estonia, Moldova, and Georgia. And the president, where is he? He's deploying additional U.S. forces to hunt down African warlords before he even sent promised MREs to the Ukraine. If you had told me in 2009 that this is where we'd be in 2014, with another 2.5 years of what passes for leadership ahead of us, I'd have told you not in America. No American president would ever surrender our responsibility to lead in favor of leading from behind. We are here today dealing with the president's FY15 missile defense budget request. We have come full circle. The president will propose the policies he wants, but he can't get them funded unless we let him. As chairman of this subcommittee, I want to make it clear he will get no help from me. Weakness is a choice. I choose peace through strength. That is why my colleagues Ted Poe and Joe Heck joined me in introducing a bicameral resolution with Senator Rubio calling on the president to declare Russia to be in violation of the INF Treaty, something we have reportedly known about for years. We simply cannot allow Vladimir Putin to continue to think he can get away with whatever he wants without consequences, as he is doing today in Ukraine and elsewhere. To the witnesses, let me be clear, these remarks and my concerns do not rest with you, Admiral and General. Your lifetime of service is a credit to your nation, and we owe you a debt of gratitude to you and your families. Ms. Bunn, I have reviewed your bio and know that you are here today as a sense of service to our nation, and I thank you. But the present trajectory is all too reminiscent to me of earlier years of failed leadership and retrenchment. My reading of history informs me that each previous era was followed quickly by a devastating and likely avoidable war. I don't know that this time will be any different, but with unanimous consent, I will add my full statement for the record. With that, I recognize my good friend and colleague, Mr. Cooper from Tennessee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thought you sounded better with the mic off. And I'm very glad that you did not read your entire statement, because if it was like what we heard, I only shudder at the consequences. This must be an election year. I thought that statement from my good friend was needlessly alarmist and partisan. You know, I yearn for the days when Americans pulled together and politics stopped at the water's edge, especially in moments of uncertainty and some crisis around the world. I think it's a serious mistake to just have a political policy of blaming everything on the president. I hope that the chairman read the memo, because in the committee memo, it says things like, phase four of the planned deployment for 2020 is now terminated, and the committee's own memo says, as a result of congressional budget actions. The president can be faulted for many things, but some parts of the missile defense budget are actually increased substantially. And for the chairman to blame sequestration on the president, saying that he proposed it, sequestration was never intended to go into effect. The congressional Super Committee was supposed to come up with a sensible solution to our budget problems. And yet we still have no solution. So regardless of the needless partisan fighting here, I think it's a mistake to make broadside charges like the president virtually ignoring threats around the world. Give me a break. We're all Americans. We all want a stronger country. We all want a strong missile defense. And we all should pay for it. So I hope my colleagues, particularly on the majority side, will help us figure out to pay for the defense they brag about so much. Because we have short-funded defense for a long time and also hamstrung the Pentagon by not allowing the Pentagon the flexibility to put money where it needs to be put. So I hate to make a statement like this, Mr. Chairman, but you were a little bit out of bounds, I thought, in your remarks. So let's have a better tone for the remainder of the hearing.
And colleague in Tennessee. Lieutenant General Mann, you're recognized for your opening statement.
Chairman Rogers, Ranking Member Cooper, other members of the subcommittee, thank you for your continued support of our soldiers, civilians, and their families. This is my first appearance before this subcommittee, and it's an honor to appear before you today to discuss the importance of missile defense for our nation and the need to maintain these capabilities in face of a maturing threat and declining budgets. Today, I would like to briefly discuss global missile defense operations in the Space and Missile Defense Command, Army Forces Strategic Command's role as a force provider. To accomplish our assigned missions, we have three core tasks. First, to provide trained and ready missile defense forces today. Secondly, to build future missile defense forces and capabilities for tomorrow. And third, to develop future technologies for the day after tomorrow. In addition, I'd like to outline the role of the Joint Functional Component Command for Integrated Missile Defense as an operational integrator on behalf of Strategic Command. We execute four tasks in support of these responsibilities. First, to synchronize operational planning. Secondly, to support ongoing operations and asset management. Third, to integrate training and exercises and test activities. And finally, to advocate for future capabilities. This subcommittee's continued support of missile defense and of our soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines, and civilians who develop, deploy, and operate these missile defense capabilities is extremely essential. Again, I appreciate the opportunity to talk about the importance of missile defense and look forward to answering any questions that you may have. Thank you.
I thank you, General. Thank you for your service. Admiral Searing.
Good afternoon, Chairman Rogers, Ranking Member Cooper, distinguished members of the subcommittee. I greatly appreciate the opportunity to testify in front of you today. Our budget request for fiscal year 2015 will support the warfighter and needs of the combatant commanders by continuing the development of the integrated ballistic missile system to protect our nation, deployed forces, allies, and international partners from an ever-increasingly capable enemy ballistic missile. My highest near-term priority remains the successful GMD intercept flight test of the CE-2 exo-atmospheric kill vehicle. In January of 2013, we conducted a highly successful non-intercept flight of the CE-2 EKV. The EKV's performance exceeded our expectations and confirmed that we are on the right path to return the GMD system to rigorous flight testing. I'm confident that we have fixed the problem we encountered in the December 2010 test, and I look forward to conducting FTG-06B intercept test this summer. Sir, I am also optimistic we have identified the root cause of the intercept failure of the first generation EKV last July. In FTG-07, the CE-1 kill vehicle and the GBI did not separate from the booster's third stage. We have accounted for the issue in our preparations for the upcoming flight test and are working towards a correction to the entire fleet before the end of this year. With this budget, we will maintain our commitment to build out homeland defenses from 30 to 44 GBIs and take steps significantly to redirect the GMD program and up our homeland defense. In 2015, we will begin to redesign and improve the GBI EKV. The new EKVs will be more producible, testable, reliable, cost-effective, and eventually replace the kill vehicle used in our GBI fleet. Because we believe that improving our discrimination capability will improve the overall performance of our existing homeland defense, we will begin development of a long-range discriminating radar with deployment planned in 2020. The new long-range mid-course tracking radar will provide persistent coverage and improve discrimination capabilities against threats to the homeland from the Pacific theater. Our budget request continues our strong support of regional defense initiatives and includes investments in our future advanced capabilities. Continuing efforts to improve the performance of the Aegis weapon system, we will procure 30 standard missile Block 1B guided missiles in FY15, plus advanced procurement for a multi-year procurement request in FY16. We plan to increase the SM-3 delivery rate in the out years. In fiscal year 2015, we will also procure 31 interceptors for THAAD, and pursuant to our agreement with the Army, fund additional TPY-2 radar spares and an additional THAAD battery. Phase 2 and Phase 3 of the European Phased Adaptive Approach are on schedule and will meet the presidential mandate for deployment. The Aegis Ashore site in Devslu, Romania, will be integrated into the EUCOM command and control network, tested and operational by December 2015 to support Phase 2. This budget also supports continued procurement of equipment for Aegis Ashore in Poland, which is planned to be operational in the 2018 timeframe. The SM-3 Block 2A, under co-development with the Japanese government, and an upgraded version of the Aegis weapon system are also both on schedule and available for deployment in 2018. We are preparing for Aegis Ashore flight tests at the Pacific Missile Range facility in Hawaii this year and again in 2015. In 2015, we plan to conduct 15 flight tests. We will continue to test elements of the system to demonstrate that they work before they are fielded. Our advanced technology investments will enable us to deploy a future BMDS architecture more capable of discriminating and killing reentry vehicles with a high degree of confidence. It is vital that we provide the warfighters the most advanced, cost-effective, and reliable weapon systems they need to do their jobs. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I look forward to the committee's questions.
I thank you, Admiral. And Ms. Bunn, the floor is yours to summarize your statement.
Thank you, Chairman Rogers, Ranking Member Cooper, distinguished members of the subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today on the department's fiscal year 15 budget request. And I do want to thank all of you for your contributions for in providing for the common defense. Missile defense is a critical national security priority, both for the protection of the United States and for the defense of our deployed forces and our allies. I would like to submit my full written statement for the record, but I'll just highlight a few key points now, if I could. Our first missile defense policy priority is the defense of the United States against the threat of limited ballistic missile attack. We currently have coverage of the U.S. homeland against potential ICBM attacks from states like North Korea and Iran. To ensure that we stay ahead of the threat, we're taking several steps to strengthen our homeland defense posture. We're deploying 14 additional interceptors in Alaska and a second missile defense radar to Japan, and requesting funding for the development of a radar that, when it's deployed in Alaska, will provide persistent sensor coverage and improve discrimination capabilities against threats to the homeland from North Korea. Also for homeland defense, as Admiral Searing mentioned, we are initiating a redesign of the kill vehicle for the ground-based interceptor. Investment in the next-generation kill vehicle for the GBI is especially important considering the issues associated with the current kill vehicles that was discovered during testing. As directed by Congress, MDA is also evaluating four potential locations in the United States for additional interceptors. Conducting the evaluation and the associated environmental impact statement process will shorten the construction timelines associated with deployment of a new missile site. We have not made a decision to build an additional missile field in the United States. While an additional missile defense site could be used to improve our homeland defenses in the future, our highest funding priorities are focused on improving interceptor reliability and performance, along with improving sensor coverage and discrimination for homeland defense. Strengthening our regional missile defense posture is also a key policy priority. We're continuing to implement regional missile defenses that are tailored to Europe, to the Middle East, to Asia Pacific. Our focus is on developing and fielding capabilities that are mobile and capable of being redeployed as necessary to address the threat. We're also encouraging our allies and partners to acquire missile defenses and to strengthen operational missile defense cooperation. Our missile defense deployments to Europe are especially important for reassuring allies of our commitment to the security of the NATO alliance. We already maintain a missile defense ship presence in the Eastern Mediterranean, along with a radar deployed in Turkey. Those have been there since 2011. And our plans to deploy Aegis Ashore sites to Romania in 2015 and Poland in 2018 are, as Admiral Searing said, on schedule. With regard to talks with Russia on transparency and cooperation, Russia's intervention in Ukraine in violation of international law led to the suspension of our military-to-military dialogues, including DoD civilians, and we have subsequently not continued to engage Russia on the topic of missile defense. In summary, we've made very significant progress deploying missile defenses and cooperating with allies and partners, but we cannot afford to stand still. The President's budget request reflects our goal of retaining the flexibility to adjust and enhance our defenses as the threat and technologies evolve. Thank you for inviting me here today, and I look forward to your questions.
I thank you, Ms. Bunn. And I'll start off with the questions. Admiral Searing, I'm concerned with Russia's behavior threatening our allies, including the illegal invasion of the Ukraine and its violation of the INF Treaty. Are you concerned about those things?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me what is the organic capability of the Aegis Ashore to detect cruise missiles?
It's currently not configured for cruise missiles. It's configured against the ballistic missile defense threat.
What would be the capability if we deployed the SM-2s and the SM-6s at those sites in addition to the SM-3s?
Again, sir, it hasn't been designed for the SM-2. As you know, we have a seaborne capability with SM-2s and SM-6s that is possible. I'd have to defer to policy or State Department on that needed capability.
What's the functional difference?
Essentially the software with a minor hardware addition.
Okay. You made reference in your state testimony, and Ms. Bunn confirmed that you're on time for the Romania and Poland Aegis Ashore sites. If the President were to come to you and say, I need you to step that up as a consequence of the Ukrainian activity by Russia, would you be able to, if he gave you the money, if money was not the issue, to step that up and make it happen quicker?
We've analyzed that. It can be done quicker if money were available, but the budget request supports a 2018 fielding at this point.
Okay. I support the additional funding of the GMD program that you requested for a new redesigned kill vehicle and new investments in discrimination. Absent these investments, however, the GMD system is actually being cut in your fiscal year 2015 budget. Why?
If I can, sir, talk about the overall, I'll talk about the GM program, but let me put it in the overall Homeland Defense category. In terms of, you and I have had many discussions on the need to improve our Homeland Defense, and that includes increasing our discrimination capability, increasing our long-range radar capability, getting started with the redesign of the EKV, all fundamental parts of Homeland Defense. And those were market increases in this year's budget. And the GM budget did go down slightly, but with the addition of the EKV and the other aspects of Homeland Defense, I'm confident we're on solid footing. That said, a big part of what I will do and have been doing is looking inside the fundamentals of the GM program, the first of which was the EKV development, which I recommended and the department supported. There's other aspects of the GMD program that I'll be looking at in the 16 budget submission for increased funding.
Are we making sufficient investments to pay for the life cycle maintenance and aging and reliability for this 10-year-old system, which, as you know, was deployed with a 20-year design life?
Not as much as I would like.
Okay. And finally, Admiral Searing, and then I will yield and hopefully I have a second round of questions, but I do want to ask you, your budget request for 2015 includes funding for several important new initiatives for homeland missile defense, including a new long-range radar, new discrimination systems, and a new homeland defense kill vehicle. What happens to these investments if the sequestration returns in 2016, as is currently the law of the land?
Everything would be put back on the table for reconsideration and possibly stopped.
Thank you. On that depressing note, I'll yield to my friend and colleague, Mr. Cooper from Tennessee.
The chairman and I actually get along very well. We had a nice breakfast together talking about submarines. It's amazing to me that I was blindsided by his statement. And also, I think the tone is just unfortunate. But rather than prolong that, I think it's important that the public get the facts. And of course, we in a democracy operate at a disadvantage because other nations don't have hearings like this, and they don't air their dirty laundry to the world, and they don't express disagreements. I hope that the public understands that, you know, we can have a stronger defense as we want to have, but just got to pay for it, not borrow the money from China as we have been doing. And in terms of getting more money for projects, the Pentagon testified for us, the Secretary of Defense, the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, and the Comptroller, that currently in the Pentagon we have 25% surplus capacity. And this Congress, this committee, refuses to allow the Pentagon to do anything about that because those bases are located in particular members' districts. So people who complain about a shortage of funding and then don't allow the Pentagon to prioritize, or people who are not willing to fund our warfighters overseas and at home, should stop complaining. This budget, you know, we wish it could be better, and it can be better if Congress has the gumption to vote for a better, stronger budget. Left unsaid in the chairman's remarks is the last three tests of ground-based interceptors have failed, and we have to acknowledge that. And that doesn't mean it's a bad program. When America ventured into rocketry, many of our missiles failed, but we solved those problems. We are a can-do nation, and as the Admiral testified, we will solve this problem. I hope your confidence is not misplaced right now, because the next test is, what, in June? So,
yes, sir.
You know, I want to be an optimist about it, but the GAO and others have reported that, you know, we should, and I think the Admiral supports this, we should fly before we buy. Don't get a pig in a poke. This idea of concurrent development has stung this committee and stung the American taxpayer for a long time. So we want to be as strong as we can be, but there are certain limits to technology so far, and let's push those limits, let's make it happen. Everyone wants to do all they can for Ukraine and the good folks over there right now, but we have to be prudent and thoughtful in the way we propose interventions. And this is not a foreign policy committee. We should be an enabling committee to allow the Pentagon to have the weapons systems and the troops that it needs. Someone once said that sequestration was worse than any enemy attack that had ever been launched on us because it hit so many points in Pentagon programs that no enemy could have been that innovative, that creative, that forceful to disrupt so many of our operations. Well, this committee has the power to start stopping that mess if we've got the gumption to do so. So I appreciate the witnesses being here. I hope that we can limit the political talk during an election year. Everyone on this subcommittee, to my knowledge, is for the strongest possible missile defense. You know, we will make that happen. And quibbling over this or that does not really strengthen the country. I yield the balance of my time.
We really are good friends. You ought to hear me and my wife if you think this is bad. Who's next? Mr. Franks of Arizona is recognized for 5 minutes for any questions he may have.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Ms. Bunn, for being here and your contribution to the country. And Admiral Searing and General Mann, I want to say a special gratitude to you and all of the people in uniform. I think that your station in this arsenal of freedom is almost impossible to overstate in its importance. So many people across the world may not realize it, but we all owe you a debt of gratitude for your commitment to the peace and security, really, of the whole world, and I'm grateful to you. With that, I have to go on record here as associating myself very vigorously with the chairman's opening statement. Some of the debates that he outlined not only were on target in my judgment, but far preceded any election year, and sometimes the importance of facing mistakes presently is to hopefully prevent repeating them, and so I want to go on record that way. Admiral Searing, today we see the smallest budget request for missile defense in the 5 years that this president has submitted a budget to Congress. And if one were only to look objectively at our budget, I think he or she would think that the world is much more safe and that the ballistic missile proliferation is not rampant and at historic levels. But putting aside my own personal feelings about what I believe to be an extremely dangerous trend, I am curious about the future of ballistic missile defense. We have a request for only $13 million for directed energy technology. And can you tell the committee what other promising technologies the agency is working on, and what is the best hedge strategy, and what about the amounts we are spending today for limited ballistic missile defense, and how we best can prepare for the future to include the new EKV and the MKV?
Sir, let me cover all that at once, and I'll string this together in a coherent explanation. The $13 million that you spoke about is really the work that's going on at the two facilities that are doing our experimentation, MIT, Lincoln Lab, and DARPA, which are teamed, and then Lawrence Livermore out on the West Coast. They're working on two very promising technologies in the solid-state laser arena. And it is technology. It is high-end technology to do what they are doing with an eye towards someday, how do you package that into something that could be put into an airborne platform or a sea-based platform? It's a very, very difficult problem. They're both making progress. The DPALS, diode-pumped alkali laser system out at Livermore, is tested to 4 kilowatts. It'll be to 10 kilowatts by the end of 15. MIT has made a little bit more progress, but for a different reason, and I'll explain that. Is at 20 kilowatts with a plan to scale to 30 kilowatts by the end of 2015. It is somewhat paced by funding, unfortunately, but the reality of the budget is such that the technology is moving in line with where the budget is in terms of technology can only move so fast. We could go faster, but we're moving at the pace of demonstration at this point. It is new inventions. It is critical to where we want to be, both for discrimination technology in terms of being in the hundreds of kilowatt regime to the high-end, high-power laser hard kill capability, which we need to be at a megawatt or higher even, which we demonstrate on an airborne laser. So there's seed work going on there. There's work as well in the classified arena, which I can't speak today about, but I'd be happy to talk to you and the committee about that in a more substantial manner. Certainly lasers and laser technology is is where we want to be from a discrimination standpoint, and I would submit down the road to change the cost equation on cost per kill on the hard kill side as well. So I agree with that. If I can, just one more, sir. There's also a lot of other classified programs that I can explain offline.
I look forward to that. Mr. Chairman, some of us, and I know you are as well, concerned very much about the sequestration. And just for the record, that was indeed proposed by our president. And there are many of us on this committee that voted against that simply because we were afraid that indeed the sequestration would take place. And this makes it difficult, I know, for a multi-year procurement authority. And related to the SM-3-1B, Admiral Searing, why is this multi-year procurement authority from the Congress in FY15 so important?
Very important for us to get the production quantities up. You and I have discussed that we ideally want to be at 52 interceptors per year from a manufacturing standpoint. Obviously, our request this year is less than that, but I would just urge the committee to look at our FY13 and 14 budget requests and the timing of those contract announcements in total. In terms of in the last few months, we've put 33 plus up to 50 interceptors under contract in the last 6 months or so, so 83 or 84 interceptors. These 30 will be added to that by the end of the year. So in a period of 15 months, we'll have put under contract over 100 interceptors. And as you know, sir, that was paced by some of the technical development problems that we had with the divert system. Yeah. And we're past that and confident that we're in a stable baseline and ready for a multi-year.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentleman. Gentleman from California, Mr. Garamendi, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. I'd like to go back to the directed energy. A significant reduction year to year, down to 14. I personally have thought this would be something that we should be spending substantially more money on, and we ought to be advancing it for reasons that we've discussed and probably ought not go into in great detail here. But I'm looking at this and wondering, if we were to move $10 million from another part of your account to directed energy, for example, delay the purchase of a missile for a month, 2 months, and put it in directed energy, what would that mean to that missile program if we were to switch around and add another 10 or let's say 15 million to the 14 that's there? So which program would you like to cut by 15 million?
Sir, as you know, every interceptor, as I told Mr. Franks, is important to the warfighter at this point. We're trying to get our interceptor quantities up for both THAAD and SM-3 at rates that we're not yet to.
Okay, so we don't go to interceptors. Where would you like to take 15?
Can I take that for the record?
No.
If I can, sir, just I'll answer the question directly in terms of there is a pace to technology maturation here on both of the concepts that we're pursuing. And adding more money could help a little, but not a lot. And as long as we stay on track to demonstrate this by the end of 15, and I got to tell you, sir, both concepts are promising for different reasons. As long as you hold me to that and I make the goal of where I said I was going to be by the end of 15, I think we're on the right track here. The scaling and packaging is the next big hurdle that we're looking at in parallel.
So there's no program, so every other program is more important than, a few moments ago you said you could and would put more money into it if you could, had that money available. So every other program is more important than this one, than adding money to this one.
The pace at which we're moving and the where we are with the experiments and the tests that are going on are driven more by the technology than money at this point.
Okay. You and I are going round and round, and we're not going to get to a conclusion, but the information I have is that another 10 to $15 million would substantially advance this program.
Congressman,
General, you want to jump into this.
Well, I just like to add, as you know, the Army is also involved in directed energy technologies, and we've already successfully tested a 10-kilowatt system back in December, currently about to do another joint test of that 10-kilowatt system in May down in Florida. In addition, we're looking at taking that technology, which right now has a range of a little bit more than 5 miles, and it's really primarily focused against cruise missiles, UAVs, counter rockets, artillery mortars, and whatnot. We're looking at taking that technology and hopefully being able to mature it, as Admiral Searing is talking about, to a 50-kilowatt capability that will give us extended range.
Please continue.
So I just wanted to add that in addition to what the Missile Defense Agency is working on, we also, internal to the Army, are also looking at that because of the nature of the threat out there, cruise missiles, UAVs, and the RAM threat that's out there.
Is your technology different than the two technologies that Missile Defense is pursuing?
It is solid state. It is directed. His is a little bit looking at a higher level, looking at a different threat set than what we're looking at. We're really looking at a lower level threat set.
I think we have three different technologies then. Raising the question of three different technologies because the Army wants to do it different than missile defense, or is it something different than technology, some reason why we're pursuing three different technologies?
I would say, and I'll defer to Admiral Searing, I think that the premise of the technology as far as being directed energy is pretty much the same, but where we're looking at different threat sets and taking out an air-breathing threat or taking out a ballistic missile is a lot different than taking out a mortar.
I understand that, but that's not where my question was going. I'm out of time, but I want to find out why we have three different technologies and whether we might want to choose one or the other, one of them, and move forward with that at some point in the near future. I'll let it go at that. I'm past time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. We're going now to the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Lamborn, for his 5 minutes for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Admiral Searing or General Mann, how important is it that we keep moving forward on an East Coast site to stem the threat of an Iranian attack?
I'll go ahead and start because Admiral Searing's been getting a lot of loving here up front here. So
that's true. We love him.
You know, obviously, by having an East Coast site, it does provide dispersal of our systems. Rather than just being at Greeley or at Vandenberg Air Force Base, having a third site will basically disperse the arsenal, number one. Number two, because of the location of the East site, it gives us more battle space or more decision-making time for threats emanating out of the Middle East. So from that standpoint, that is also additive. Third, it's more, pardon the vernacular, more arrows in the quiver. We have more capability, more capacity, but not more technological capability. And so as a result, we have more of an ability to address a raid size threat that might be posed against the
U.S. Well, with that in mind, from the operational perspective that you just gave us, should we be doing more from a planning and budget perspective? I mean, the administration is going along with what Congress has directed it to do, but no further. Should we and could we be doing more?
We could always do more. I think if you're looking for my recommendations, Congressman, I would say that dealing pragmatically with the budget the way it is, I think that the best investment for the taxpayer is to increase our sensor capability and discrimination. That right there, in increasing the reliability of the EKVs. That's where, if you were asking for my recommendation, that's where I would put the next dollar.
Admiral, do you or Ms. Bunn, do you have anything to add to that?
The warfighting advantage was well explained by General Mann. We obviously agree with that entirely. In terms of are we doing enough? The work that we started with the down select of the four sites and all of the EIS work that's going to go on over the next 2 years is setting the stage for a decision if the department were to make that decision. And that's got to play out. We're on an aggressive EIS timeline if you compare it to history. And there's a lot of work that has to go on in terms of site surveys, all of the town halls, everything that will go on in parallel. I think you'll see the combatant commanders debate this requirement and debate the need. And I think General Jacoby and Admiral Haney will be in a good position to address that next year. I think that as General Jacoby testified, we're setting ourselves up in time for a decision. Okay. And you've heard me talk about the need to think near term, midterm, and far term. And I've always characterized the midterm as the 2020 timeframe.
Okay, Ms. Bunn.
I think it's been addressed, and I would agree with.
And let me ask you a question. Are we doing enough against potential Chinese threats, including cruise missiles or submarine-borne ballistic missiles?
As far as defense of the homeland, our homeland defense is geared toward states such as North Korea and Iran. With regard to regional missile defense, China does have a number of short, medium-range ballistic missiles, and that's part of why we're going forward in the Asia Pacific.
Well, and I didn't mean hundreds of missiles. I meant a rogue missile or an unauthorized or accidental launch is what I was referring to.
Yes, sir. We haven't designed against missiles from Russia or China, but if there were an accidental or unauthorized launch, we would do what we could to defend against it.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. Chair, and I recognize the gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Johnson, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for being here. I'd ask each of you to respond to this question. Has the improved missile defense of ballistic missile systems made cruise missiles more attractive to our adversaries? And if you could also just give us your current assessment of the cruise missile threat.
Thank you, Congressman. I think it's fair to say that cruise missile technology is being looked at by a number of nations. Nine right now are currently producing this capability. I think 20 more are looking into this kind of technology. So I think it's fair to say that cruise missile technology is something that many nations are looking at, and as a result, we also are looking at our defenses against that. Right here in the National Capital Region, as you know, we're about to put the Joint Attack Cruise Missile Defense Elevated Sensor, that aerostat, there at APG at Aberdeen Proving Ground to do a test on behalf of NORTHCOM to look at how do we do a better job of sensing an incoming cruising missile and being able to defeat it. And utilizing some of the systems that we have around this area, like the NASAMS missile, for instance. So that's one of the things that we're looking at right now, at how do we bolster up, in terms of the NCR, our ability to address that threat. I talked earlier about high-energy laser technologies, and that's something that the Army is also looking at in terms of countering the cruise missile threat that might be out there. So this is definitely an area that many countries are looking into.
I would just add to the general's point that from a ballistic missile standpoint, which is my job, I don't see any of that threat de-escalating in favor of cruise missile threat. I see these both increasing at a very rapid pace.
I would agree that we don't want ballistic missiles to be a free ride for a potential adversary, nor cruise missiles either.
Thank you. Also, understanding that you are performing environmental impact statements for four potential sites, what is the rough order estimated cost of the East Coast Missile Defense site?
The estimate that we've gone on record is in the rough order of $3 to $4 billion, which would include the site and 20 interceptors. Now, that will be refined as we study in more detail the four sites that we're looking at, and that cost estimate will be submitted as part of the contingency plan updates that we provide the Congress over the next 2 years.
I want to ask all of you this question. Is one successful flight intercept sufficient to give us sufficient confidence to invest additional billions of dollars in deploying and procuring 14 additional GBIs?
Let me take that, and the gentleman from a deployment standpoint can address the warfighter confidence with deployment. As the chairman has said, as the ranking member has said, the last three flight tests were 0 for 3 in terms of intercept tests.
They were what?
0 for 3 in the last three intercept tests that were conducted. The history of this program is that in intercept tests in the GM program, it's actually 8 for 16, 15 if you count it somewhat different. The CE-1, and I won't throw too much configuration jargon here, but the oldest version that was deployed first was actually 3 for 3 before the last failure in July, so 3 for 4 of that version. What we're talking about in terms of, that's one of the three pass failures. There were two failures in a row of the new one, of the new configuration. One failed because of a lock wire missing, and one failed because of excessive vibration in the inertial measurement unit, both very mechanical in nature. The first one, obviously, quality in nature. So your point is, if we go and test again this summer, what does that mean in terms of our confidence to continue production and deployment of the missile? And I'll let General Mann answer the deployment question. But if you think about sort of The new version with the corrections was flown back in January of 13 very successfully. It was a non-intercept flight, but we put it in space and put it through its paces. This will be the intercept test this summer of that configuration. And in this year's budget request, there are three more intercept tests scheduled for 15, 16, and 17 of the latest configuration. And I would say all of those will be the benchmarks of confidence for the warfighter to deploy the system.
Congressman, I agree with General Jacoby's assessment. We have confidence in the current capability. Do we need to do more? Do we need to continue to do the necessary testing? Yes. But we have confidence in the operational employment, the rules of engagement that we would use that would address maybe some reliability or some uncertainty associated with the system. I think what is key is that, as Admiral Searing was talking about, is that we sustain a make sense test program from year to year. We maintain that, make sure that it has the predictability that it needs, that we continue ongoing efforts to redesign or to upgrade the current EKV, as well as looking at leap ahead technologies. So don't know if that answers your question, but I think that the way ahead is pretty well stated. We'll see what happens with this test coming up. And also, as Admiral Searing stated, before last summer's CE-1 failure, they had three successful intercepts right before that.
Gentlemen's time's expired. Chair, now recognize the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Turner, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just one quick comment in defense of our chairman. I believe our chairman cited the Washington Post March 2nd editorial that had the heading, President Obama's foreign policy is based on fantasy. And I just want to underscore the fact that the Washington Post is certainly not up for re-election, and they certainly are not seen as being partisan against the president. So considering that they are, that their comments are consistent with our chairman, I believe that it's certainly important for him to raise the issues as to how the policy of the administration affects the issues that are within the jurisdiction of the subcommittee. I'd like to ask, if the chairman has not, that editorial be entered into the record of this hearing. Ms. Bunn, we had a chart that was up that said that this is the budget request for missile defense represents the smallest missile defense budget request since Bill Clinton was president. I was reading your bio, and it struck me, it seems, and I hope I'm not mistaking this, but I was reading all the different positions that you have. It seems that your position, which now includes missile defense policy, that the last time that you had a title that also included the words missile defense policy was the Clinton administration. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, that was the last time. The first time was in the Reagan administration, and then in the George H.W. Bush administration.
Well, sometimes things repeat themselves. What struck me about that was when I read the conclusion to your statement, it says, the ballistic missile threat to the United States, to our allies and partners, and to our forces overseas is evolving, and we continue to grow and adapt our homeland and regional missile defense posture and international cooperation to address it. Now, from my perspective, and looking at that chart and where we've been and where we're going, I mean, we were going to be at a position where the Alaska missile field was complete, and there were going to be GBIs, ground-based, forward deployed in Europe. This administration cut completing the Alaska field and then cut the forward base missiles that was to be the third site. Do we have any request for the implementation of what had been the phase four of the phase adaptive approach by the administration?
Sir, when I talked about the growth, I was referring to the additional 14 interceptors that we've decided to deploy.
To where?
For homeland defense.
Where are they deployed?
They will be deployed in Alaska.
But those are the ones that were already scheduled. So you can't say you're growing something when you've cut it, and then you decide to put back portion, but not all, of what you cut. So my question to you was, is there any budgetary request that includes funding of any portion of the implementation of what was phase four, the phase adaptive approach?
No, sir.
No, there's not.
So
we don't grow. We actually only have a replacement of missiles that the Bush administration had proposed, correct? You can turn your mic back on. I'm not finished.
Sir, they had originally wanted 14 more. Decision was made to go toward defending Europe against Iranian threats, and so that was funding was.
So the answer is just yes, right?
I mean, the answer is yes.
Right, right. So yes, you haven't grown it. You first cut the missiles in Alaska. Then you cut the forward deployed missiles. Then you're going back and putting some more in Alaska, and that's still not a net growth. We're still behind. You say we cannot afford to stand still. We're not. We're moving backwards. I appreciate the analysis that we had on the East Coast missile defense site gets us, and there's terms that people banter around on validated military requirement, and I wanted you to help us on that. Because it seems to me there's only three ways to criticize this, that there's no threat, we don't need it yet, and money. And I think we can resolve all those. But then they throw in this validated military requirement. Admiral Stirling, could you please describe what validated military requirement is and tell us how does that relate to any MDA system for the phase adaptive approach, for SM-3, 2A, interceptor, any?
Yes, sir. As you know, MDA is not under the JSIDS process. And the Joint Staff Requirements process. When I talk about a validated requirement in missile defense terms, I'm talking about a requirement that is on the STRATCOM priority capability list or the NORTHCOM integrated priority list. And if there's a requirement that is in there that talks to, for example, the East Coast missile site, that to me is a requirement, and we can go back to those lists and we can trace things that we are building, systems that we are providing, to those requirements in the capabilities list.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate that our debate continues to be on the issue of threat and timing and money, because I think anybody who's had any of the classified briefings on this know that the threat is there, the timing is now, and the dollars need to be placed there by this Congress. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman, and just for the record, I know I've had this conversation with both General Mann and Admiral Searing in private, but I very much support directed energy And I support what Mr. Garamendi was talking about a little while ago. And if, in fact, it's just a matter of y'all needing some more money, I hope you'll let us know, because we may not be able to get you to find it, but we'll figure out a way to find it, because I think that is the future. And I would like to see us be aggressive in pursuing that technology. Oh, Mr. Brooks, he came back. I'm sorry. Chair, I recognize Mr. Brooks for any questions he may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Admiral Searing, on virtually all major missile defense and strategic missile programs such as PAC-3, Aegis, THAAD, and Minuteman, testing is typically conducted multiple times a year to ensure ongoing reliability and operational readiness. However, since the inception of the Ground-Based Mid-Course Defense Program, testing occurs sometimes less than once a year. And unfortunately, testing seems to be driven more from problems that arise instead of catching issues that could be caught long before they arise if a more robust testing program was in place. Do you agree that the more testing we do on a more frequent basis would help the GMD system?
Yes, sir.
Why?
Testing is the ultimate graduation exercise to the systems that we're fielding. And ground-based testing is necessary but not sufficient. Ideally, sir, you're absolutely right that we want to be, you know, out in front and testing the new capabilities, new reliability improvements that are added to graduate them to the fleet. And that's where we want to be on an annual basis at a minimum.
What is holding us back from conducting a more robust testing program?
Technical issues on the new interceptors was the biggest reason for the delay. And you know, when I came in as a director, my priority was to go back and get a CE-1 interceptor flight tested as soon as possible, and we did that.
Is funding an issue with respect to those technical issues?
Funding is always an issue, and we're always prioritized, but I can assure you that we didn't go any slower because of funding to resolve the technical issues.
All right, thank you. General Mann, please switch hats for a moment to your hat as Commander of Army Space and Missile Defense Command. Why is the conventional prompt global strike capability important?
Congressman, that capability provides us the ability to strike anywhere in the world in under an hour, and don't necessarily need to have a forward deployed element that's out there to be able to do that. It also allows us to address time-sensitive targets or targets that are fleeting. I would say it also provides a capability if we were to enter a NA access or NA denial environment where the lodgment or the forward operating bases may be contested. So it does provide a capability to be able to address some of those issues.
I've been informed the Navy is evaluating the basing of such capabilities on submarines. Do you support that view?
Congressman, I know that you know, the Navy is looking at this technology. What I can tell you is my command, as you know, very, very proud of the efforts of the folks there in Redstone as well as Sandia Labs on our successful test that took place back in November 11. And we're encouraged, we're on track to execute the August test. And then from there, you know, we'll take direction from OSD as to where they want to go. I do know that the Navy is looking at this. They're looking at it in terms of the size configurations and how it could possibly be placed on different platforms.
And this is a question for any of you. How much does America spend on ground-based mid-course defense?
We've spent, and Mr. Chairman, if I can just check this for the record, $24 billion to date, $30 billion by 2019.
How about in the last fiscal year, how much was spent? Do you know offhand?
In fiscal year 14, it was roughly $1 billion. With all of the Homeland Defense improvements in this year budget, we're at $1.3 billion.
The reason I mention that is that there was some discourse about BRAC. And certainly to the extent BRAC can be more efficient, that's something Congress ought to consider. But at the same time, it seems like that's a drop in the bucket when you look at $750 billion a year that this government is spending on means-tested welfare or wealth transfer programs. And I would submit that's a place that perhaps we need to be looking at in order to help prevent the degradation of our national security capabilities. Or perhaps look at the $40 to $50 billion a year we spend giving away to foreign entities, money again that we have to borrow, that we can't pay back to give it away. And so as we're looking at BRAC, I would hope that the members of this committee and the members of Congress generally would also look at all these much more glaring expenses that, at least to me, are a lesser priority than funding our national security. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman, and I'm impressed, Admiral Searing, that you remember those numbers, those spending numbers. That was pretty good. I only have one question left, and that was for Ms. Bunn. As you know, this committee, in its report to accompany the FY14 NDAA, directed DOD and the Department of State to provide a full report on its dealings with Russia on the U.S. missile defenses. We have a responsibility to our constituents to understand what has been proposed, especially when we understand, as was just confirmed, that the Obama appointees had sought to provide Russia classified information on our missile defenses. I understand that the Department of Defense is offering to brief us, and that may be sufficient, but I see nothing about the State Department responding. Why is that?
Congressman, in December, when the Undersecretary for Policy came to brief Chairman McKeon and others, there was a State Department representative with him. He briefed then on the MDA presentations that had been used with Russia. We've now compiled others. As you know, you've gotten a recent letter saying perfectly willing to come and brief on those as well. I suspect the State will be with us. And otherwise, you'd have to ask the State Department.
Okay. Thank you. Chair, I recognize the ranking member for any questions he may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd be happy to yield to my friend from Texas, who's been here waiting at the hearing for some time. If Mr. Vesey would like to use my time.
Is this the appropriate time to ask about the missile defense? That's what I wanted to talk about. Okay, yeah. Wanted to ask you about request for missile defense funding. How did that fare in the FY15 budget request?
We were successful in the department requesting just under $7.5 billion.
Okay. Were your requests prioritized?
Yes, sir.
They were, okay.
And I just add, very strongly supported by the department.
Okay, good, good. And I wanted to also ask, and I think that either one of you can answer this particular question about the left of launch. And I wanted to know, do we have sufficient intelligence to inform left of launch options?
I think that's an area that I think all the combatant commanders would agree is an area that we need to continue to improve our capabilities for left to launch. You know, obviously this is a policy issue, but in terms of the ISR, improving our ISR abilities to be able to see where threat systems are at or located on the battlefield, I would say this is an area, obviously, that we can always do better.
I can just add, I think you heard for the record from General Jacoby that he would, that's at the top of his priority list, is increased indications and warning capability.
And I would add that we need a mix of capabilities to deal with adversary ballistic missiles. Part of that has to do with missile defense, and part of that has to do with other capabilities for strike. Okay. And the intelligence ability, the ability to find and fix those is one that we is very important.
Thank you.
Gentleman from Arizona, Mr. Franks, is recognized.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's been an interesting discussion here. And Admiral Searing, I assure you the last thing I want to do is to keep hammering on you or put you in an awkward position in any way. But we have, I think, what is it, about 30-plus Aegis capable ships and test site in Hawaii, and we have ashore sites coming online in Romania and Poland. I think it is. They're on time in 2015, 2018, both of those?
Correct, sir.
And with all of these avenues to defend from, the fact remains that we've cut more than 90 SM-3 1Bs out of the FYDP and more than 20 in this year's budget alone. And I want you to know, I understand that this is a challenge that has been forced upon you. But in the way that you feel that you can you give us any guidance, this committee, as to why these cuts should take place, and can we work together to try to maybe right this ship if we're under giving less rounds than we may need at some point to justify, not only justify, but to populate these new avenues of these sites that are coming online.
Thank you, Mr. Franks. As you know, and I'll talk to the total quantity here in just a second. As you know, we also requested advanced procurement in this year's budget, which will set the stage for the multi-year procurement request in 16 through 19. And the goal, negotiation goal, objective, is to get as close to 52 per year through the multi-year procurement savings, which have to be at least 10%, and we're hoping to be more like 15 to 20% to get the quantities back up towards 52. And, sir, it was a balance of risk this year, and I explained this. We were late to award the 13 quantity. We just awarded the 14 quantity. The 15 quantity will be added on. If you look at those three together, it's 115 missiles in a period of 15 months. And given the other priorities in the budget, sir, that was the choice that was made to get the Homeland Defense Initiative started.
I don't question your choice at all. It does underscore the need to try to head off the sequester in 2016. Let my final question be to all of you here, and just one general comment. What do you believe you need most from us now? What is the most important thing that we can do to empower you to do the jobs that you're so capably already doing?
Address sequestration. obviously, predictability in terms of funding, and as Admiral Searing has articulated, as far as priority, the best use of taxpayer dollars, I would say the support for long-range discrimination, as well as to maintain confidence in our GBIs that we have up there, as well as LEAP-HEB technologies.
That's a really good answer. Oh.
Mm-hmm. I'm comforted by your support, by the committee's support with our censoring and discrimination effort that needed to get started to make the best use of the interceptors we have, sir, as we've discussed. Mm-hmm. And I just ask for that continued support. The second part is advanced technology and support to continue to accelerate those efforts, some of which we can't talk about here, yeah. But I agree with you entirely in terms of we can't just keep building bigger and bigger missiles. At some point, we've got to bring that technology along, and it's got to be disruptive.
Yeah. Ms. Budden.
Instead of talking to hear myself talk, Congressman, I will just say amen and amen.
That's a good answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Chairman, I recognize Mr. Longman for any questions he may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank our panel for being here today. I apologize if it was not here earlier. It's the downside of this job. You have to be in five places at the same time all at the same time. So, but thank you for your testimony, and I know that was a pretty robust discussion on directed energy, so I won't delve back into that area. But I would I'd like to ask a question with respect to acquisitions. And procurement. So in May 2013, GAO had concluded that despite some progress, and I quote, MDA has undertaken and continues to undertake highly concurrent acquisitions. While some concurrency is understandable, committing to product development before requirements are understood and technologies are mature, or committing to production and fielding before development is complete, is a high-risk strategy that often results in performance shortfalls, unexpected cost increases, schedule delays, and test problems. It can also create pressure to keep producing to avoid work stoppages, end quote. So previous EKV development and deployment have been rushed with deployment preceding operationally realistic testing. How will MDA reduce acquisition risk for the development of the new common kill vehicle?
First, Congressman, good to see you, sir. We agree with the GAO's assertion on concurrency, and we've taken action to rectify that within the Missile Defense Agency, where every program today is required to address concurrency in the execution briefs that I receive quarterly, in terms of what areas of concurrency do you have, how are you managing them, what risks do you have, and what are you going to do to decouple efforts if required. You can't ever manage in a zero concurrent nature in a program. It's unaffordable and will never deliver. It's a matter of managing that concurrency and understanding it. Specifically to your question on the EKV, CKV, I can assure you, I've told people this, we have one chance to get it right. And circumventing the system engineering design cycle, prototype testing, and qualification will not happen. There's a very rigorous process that's followed for properly engineered missile systems. I've got a lot of experience with the Aegis development and the Standard Missile in particular, that history of following that process, and I assure you that it'll be followed in the EKB development.
Thank you, Admiral. I appreciate those assurances. I know the committee is going to want to continue to follow this closely. So thank you for your work on that. I will ask one question, I think, that hasn't been asked on directed energy, and that's respect to foreign collaboration with partners. Are there other opportunities for collaboration with partner nations in directed energy research? And if so, can you outline what those are, both current and future?
Currently none. There are opportunities which, as we flush those out over the next few months to a year, we'll get back to you on, but there are several opportunities abroad that we're thinking through.
Okay, very good. Thank you all for the work you're doing. I'm going to stop there. I'll yield back the balance of my time, and I appreciate you all being here today. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. Chair, and I recognize the gentleman from Huntsville, Alabama, Mr. Brooks, for any additional questions he may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Bunn, do you know why Dr. Miller, the previous Undersecretary of Defense for Policy, sought approval to release MDA's velocity at burnout information to Russia?
Sir, what Dr. Miller asked for was an assessment of the risk of doing so. MDA provided that analysis, and it was not released.
Why did he seek that assessment?
It was part of the efforts that have gone on for several administrations to convince the Russians that our missile defense capabilities in Europe don't pose a threat to their strategic deterrent. The talks where we keep saying we're not going to accept limits. The Russians keep seeking limits. We were looking for other ways to address this without seeking limits. So that was the reason.
Do you support such a release of MDA's velocity at burnout information to Russia or any other potential foe of the United States of America?
Given the risk assessment that MDA did, I would not.
And Admiral Searing, did you approve a release of the velocity at burnout data at any point in time?
No, sir.
And was that a part of the assessment that Ms. Bunn has just finished testifying to?
Yes, sir.
And why would a foe of the United States of America find that velocity at burnout information of value?
Let me try to answer that unclassified, and if I need to go classified, I'd ask that I come see you about that. It gets to methods and means of employment that could be derived from such equations.
And this would be a question for any of the three of you that wish to answer. Do you have a judgment as to whether the release of velocity at burnout information in any way, shape, or form has the potential to undermine America's national security capabilities, in particular with respect to missile defense?
In my view, yes. And the uncertainty of where that information would go, and my firm recommendation not to release it.
General Mann, do you have an opinion?
I agree.
And Ms. Bunn?
As I said, given the risk assessment that MDA produced, I would not favor releasing that.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank the gentleman, Chair, and I recognize the gentleman from California, Mr. Garamendi, for a second round of questions, if he has any.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You're going to be doing another test firing, Admiral. If it doesn't work, what's plan B?
If it doesn't work, it could fail for many different reasons, and we'll go through that as we do with every failure, an analysis of what failed and why it failed.
So plan B is to continue to pursue the current technology.
The success or failure of this test this summer, as I've talked to you, sir, about, is in no way going to change my decision or recommendation to pursue the redesigned EKV.
Okay. The there was a question raised earlier about this new missile defense site somewhere on the East Coast, and I thought I heard one or maybe two of you, Ms. Byrne and maybe Admiral, or General, I'm not sure which of the three of you, say that the current array of missiles provide adequate protection from the present and known threats from Iran and North Korea. Is that correct?
Yes, Congressman. It does provide a limited defense against threats emanating from North Korea and Iran.
Now, you used a qualifying word there, so let's go at that word, limited. What do you mean by that?
Excuse me, given their current capability, it does provide the protection. But we all know that these countries are continuing to increase their arsenal and their technology. And down the road, they might reach a point in terms of numbers, just the numbers of missiles that they could employ, that it could overwhelm the system.
Okay.
Down the road.
So now the solution there might be to increase the number of missiles in Vandenberg and Alaska, or to have a new missile defense site.
Or it could be to also continue to increase the reliability and the effectiveness of the current fleet, too. And that would also have an operational employment aspect to it. So, and that's the reason why we support the Missile Defense Agency's current approach in terms of increasing the effectiveness and the efficiency of the current systems.
OK.
as well as looking ahead.
So there are multiple ways of going at this problem of increased capability by Iran and North Korea, and I suppose somebody else out there that might come along. And that might be to make a better kill system, one that's more accurate, more agile, and increase the number of missiles at the present site. It seems to me the system that you have set up, correct me if I'm wrong now, is one in which you want to first make sure you know what's going on. And this is the increased capacity of the radar systems, that's the high priority. Get that done so you know what's coming in. Secondly, develop a missile that actually will work. It has multiple capabilities. And then make a decision about adding to the existing number of missiles and possibly an additional missile site. Is that the track you're on?
Or I would add to that, Congressman, I'd add to that. I think also it gets back to, I think some of the, I think General Jacoby also highlighted the importance of making sure in terms of indications and warning that we continue to work on our ability to locate threat systems. I think that's really the first step, to make sure that, number one, we're able to identify those threat platforms that are out there. And in addition to increasing our sensor, our ability to discriminate, to be able to find the target within a threat complex, and then to be able to utilize the GBIs now and in the future in the most efficient means possible.
And that is the track that is in the current budget?
Yes, sir.
With the exception of directed energy?
There's aspects of directed energy that we need to spend some time with in a classified forum so I can give you the complete picture.
I'll yield back my time. Thank you.
Thank the gentleman, Chair, and I recognize the ranking member for any questions he may have.
I thank the Chair. I just wanted to thank the witnesses not only for their testimony, but for their hard work every day in defending America. I think the most important single word that was uttered in this hearing was uttered by General Mann in response to, I think, Mr. Frank's question of what we could do to help you do your work better. And basically you said, sequestration, get rid of sequestration. So I hope the committee heard that testimony, and I hope this committee will act to eliminate sequestration. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. Any other questions from any members? Okay, I hear none. And I completely echo the ranking member's statement. I have made it clear to the chairman of the full committee and to our House leadership that it is my number one priority to see sequestration, defense sequestration in particular, rolled back and eliminated. I think it's going to do great damage to this country, so hopefully we will be successful, but I can assure you it is a top priority of mine over the next year or so while we navigate these waters. But thank y'all again for your time and your expertise and your service to our country. And with that, we're adjourned.
I'm going to go to the next one.